Hello. We are back with episode 6 of the drunkenly critically acclaimed, soon-to-be award-winning John Sawyer Show, live on Strong Island TV. If you are watching us on Facebook Live, we thank you. If you are listening to us on the TuneIn Radio app, we also thank you. If you don't have the TuneIn Radio app and wish to get it, you can do so by going to the App Store or Google Play, depending on which one your intergalactic cellular phone device carries. Download the app for free. Look in the search engine, type Strong Island Radio. That's Strong Island instead of Long Island. And as long as you have that up, you can listen to us on the go every single week. I am your host, the Rocky Mountain Madman, the cold-blooded country boy, former pro wrestler, current actor, and male prostitute. I'm just kidding about that last one.
He's not.
I am your favorite host, Mr. John Sawyer. Sitting alongside me is my co-host, my friend, Mr. Quite Manly himself, Joe Herb.
Yes, sir.
How you doing? Sir.
Doing good. Doing good. Had a fun week. Still not back at work, so I'm just kind of relaxing.
Yeah, when do you go back?
Hopefully sometime this week or next week.
Okay, all right. Joining us in the studio tonight, we have actress and producer Requiem Aeternam from the Scream Sisters podcast. Am I saying that correctly?
No.
I am not.
I told you you weren't. I told you last week when you tried to pronounce it, you weren't.
Okay, Requiem Aeternam.
There you go.
Okay. She will be joining us shortly from the Scream Sisters podcast and Zen Productions. She'll actually be kicking off a tour on March 10th, but I'll let her tell you guys that herself. Before we get to her, somebody told me a very interesting snapping turtle story on the way over to the studio.
Interesting.
I had no idea, before you start, I had no idea that a simple little $5, hey, you want to feed the animal kind of thing, would turn into something so horrific. But I'll let him explain what happened.
Yeah, interesting, I don't think.
Well, what store was, can you say what store this was
at? I'll get to that in a minute. Relax.
Okay. Relaxed.
Let me tell my story, all right?
It's Sunday. I'm always relaxed.
I wouldn't call it
easy like Sunday evening. That sounded so weird. Go on.
Yeah. Interesting, I don't think is the right word I would use to describe it. I think disturbing. Disturbing is definitely a more appropriate word.
Disturbing than keeps you up at night.
Kind of.
Children run in terror.
Kind of.
My dog hides under the couch.
Yeah.
You know.
So I go over to quite
a perfect theme for our horror guests we have.
That's true. That's very true.
Continue.
So I go over to Jungle Bob's to take care of all of my reptile needs. Let's put it that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to go over there. Yeah. So I go over there on Valentine's Day to pick up mealworms for my gecko. Mm-hmm. And they have two tanks now. One has an alligator snapping turtle in it. The other one has an actual alligator and a little maybe 2-3 foot long alligator. And you can feed them for $5 a piece.
Right.
Now I'm figuring that, you know, the alligator snapping turtle, you know, they'll drop a fish in there and it'll eat the fish, whatever. But while I'm in there, there's this couple in there and they're looking around and stuff and they start talking about feeding the animals and everything. So they decide that they're going to pay the $5 to feed the, to see the, alligator snapping turtle get fed.
Right.
They do not drop a goldfish into the alligator snapping turtle tank. They drop a live mouse into the alligator snapping turtle tank.
Oh, stupid little.
Yeah, so they drop it in, and the thing, basically, the whole time that it's in this tank, it just, the snapping turtle, it just kind of sits in the corner with its head up and its mouth open waiting for food to come to it, because that's what they do. Mm-hmm. So they drop the mouse right over the snapping turtle's head. And at first, the snapping turtle isn't quick enough. The mouse swims away. So the guy goes and grabs the little feeding tongs and picks up the mouse by the tail and then drops it again into the right above the snapping turtle's head. And this time, it's ready for it. And pretty much as soon as it hits the water, the snapping turtle snaps its head up. And like quicker than I even saw it, it grabs the mouse by the tail and drags the mouse underwater.
Oh, my God.
And the guy's like, oh yeah, first thing it's going to do is it's gonna bring the mouse in under the water and it's going to drown it. So now this poor little mouse is being held underwater by this snapping turtle. And it's struggling so hard to get away from the snapping turtle. And after maybe like a minute of struggling to get its tail out of the snapping turtle's mouth, the snapping turtle opens its mouth again, and now it sucks half of the mouse into its mouth. So the back half of the mouse is in the snapping turtle's mouth. And the front half is outside the mouth, and it is still struggling. And it is just it like if you ever like if you ever and this brings
this
us back
so
to
awful.
This brings us back to the horror movie theme. If you ever see like a horror movie or a gory movie, and there's a thing where the person's like trapped at their waist, and they're like trying to push their way out of whatever they're trapped in, that is what this mouse was doing. Mm. And it was horrifying to watch this. And the guy standing there, and he's like, oh yeah, its jaws are powerful enough that sometimes it'll do that, and it'll just bite the mouse in half. And I'm just sitting there thinking, thank God that didn't happen. I would rather see the mouse struggle than see half of a bloody mouse body floating around in the tank.
But they're both horrible options, though.
But I would rather take the less gory one.
You'd rather be quick and painless.
Yeah.
Okay.
So then after like another minute of this mouse struggling in the snapping turtle's mouth, it then just opens its mouth all the way and inhales like the mouse whole and just swallows it. And like I'm watching it and it's like the weirdest thing. And then I go out to my truck and I'm just sitting there like oh my God, I don't ever want to see that again.
It's like Jungle Bob. You know, was sponsored by ISIS or something.
Seriously, like,
or should I say DISIS? DISIS is terrible. Hickory dickory dock. This mouse has no cock. Kill it. It's horrible. It just happened that way. Old Mother Hubbard. I'm not going to get into that. Okay.
Thank you.
Phone lines are open. You can call us at 516-945-9099. Again, the number is 516-945-9099. With that horrific story out of the way, sponsored by Dyson.
Horrific is definitely a good way to describe
it. Yeah. Now it is time to get to our guest of the evening. She is an actress, a producer, the founder, I should say, and owner and creator and leader and head presidente of Zen Productions, which will be kicking off a 3-convention tour starting March 10th. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Requiem Aeternam.
Hi, thank you.
Good to have you.
Yeah, good to be here.
You were having some trouble finding this place, weren't you?
Oh my gosh. Yeah, well, it kind of helps when I've got my GPS on and then I get a call in the middle of it and then I have no idea where the hell I am.
Yeah, you sounded like, okay, get off the phone
now. It's like, get off the phone. I need to find the place.
Hey, asshole, I'm driving over here. What's wrong with you?
Oh, man. That's funny.
Yeah. So you had a rehearsal last night for an upcoming shadow cast for Rocky Horror Picture?
No, actually, last night it was for Repo, the Genetic Opera, which is I'm wearing the shirt. Ah. And we were running auditions.
I thought it was Operation Repo.
No.
I'd rather see Operation the Genetic although Repo, the Genetic Opera, than Operation Repo.
Although I've watched that show and I've dreamed of of it being about the movie Repo, but with
that
with
would,
those
that
situations,
would make it better. That
would make
it
so
much
better. Yeah,
it would. My mother loves those shows. Yeah. Like some of them, I'm like, all right, this is cool. I watched like 2 episodes of Operation Repo, and it was like,
yeah.
Why would anyone ever watch this? Mm.
Yeah, so we were doing a rehearsal for Repo, and also we were auditioning for our newest shadow cast, which we're going to be debuting at Lunacon. Mm-hmm. Which is going to be Little Shop of Horrors.
Oh, awesome.
So,
which
that's
version?
Really exciting. The 1986.
Okay.
Rick Moranis version.
Now, how often do you hold these auditions?
Well, it depends. I mean, it depends on it. Our con season is in the spring. So normally when we do new shows like that, we have a company, a set group of people that pretty much do all our shows. You join up and you do all the shows. Sometimes I do need to go outside, especially if we're talking about some of the live theater that we've done. But normally it's like our repertory company, and it was basically seeing who in our company was going to play which role last night. Mm-hmm. So that's really what. But we're always open if people want to come audition, you know, and you know, just be prepared to give your Saturday nights up.
Yeah, I know too well about commitments, especially on the weekends and all that. So with with all of our guests we've had, why are you looking at me like I'm saying something stupid?
You mean commitments on the weekends like this?
Well, this is technically the beginning of my week, you know.
That's true. You that's know, true. It is Sunday night.
Some people begin their weeks on Fridays.
And that's true.
They have extremely abnormal life schedules.
Yep. You know? Uh-huh. Know what that's like.
So with each of our guests that we've had before, like Dan Acosta, Chris Caton, Natalie Corvino, I almost forgot her name for some reason. We always
She's only been on twice. You think you'd remember?
Yeah,
that
I'm so sorry, Natty. Please don't hurt me. well, you can if you want to. I just wouldn't prefer an audience. Wow, I just went a little weird there.
Wow. Yeah.
We always like to start.
You should see the comments on the Facebook feed.
Oh, don't tell me she's watching right now.
Okay. Not from her. Just keep talking. We're fine. You'll see it later.
Oh no. Oh, I'm embarrassing myself already.
Yep.
Okay, so, wow, I look better without my glasses. Anyway, we always like to start in the beginning with our guest. Would you stop? John Sawyer Show, fucking it up every week. We always like to start in the beginning with our guests. So, when did you start getting into the performing arts?
Oh, geez. Since I could talk.
Oh, so you did like plays at school and stuff like that?
Oh, sure. I mean, ever since I was very small, I took dance and I would always want to be in the plays, day camp. And I used to, when I was in elementary school, I used to write my own plays. I mean, they were terrible, but, they were mine. And I used to beg my teacher to let us perform them. And she's like, oh, okay, again? Okay, sure.
So you had at a young age, you were able to write your own stuff. Mm-hmm. And
yeah.
Okay. How old were you, six?
Oh, gosh. Well, no, I was a little older, like 10,
oh,
9
okay.
or 10.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they were terrible. But they were mine. Yeah,
I recall being 10 years old and telling my mom, like, I would like to do something when I'm older where it's like, we're entertaining people, but we're beating each other up on stage, but it's still a show. And I had no idea that I was hinting at wrestling. I was just so randomly, thinking at the time. She goes, my God, that sounds awful. Who would want to go see that?
And I've always been involved with some kind of performance or theater since pretty much I was able to talk. Uh-huh. I mean, in some way, I mean, I've done everything in theater that you could possibly do. I've, I've acted, of course, produced, directed, done tech, lighting, sound, set building, everything. So I've done costuming. I've played in pit bands.
Nice.
I've done all of it, and I think because I've done that, it allowed me to be where I am today as a producer. Mm-hmm. Because if you have knowledge of tech and lighting and set design and all of that, I've stage managed too, it's easier to understand what you're expecting of others.
Mm-hmm.
Because you've actually been there and done it yourself, and you know how you think that it should be done. So
what do you like more, acting or being behind the scenes?
That's tough. I mean, I've got the bug, so I always like to be acting, but there's something satisfying about a show logistically going off without a hitch and mm-hmm. knowing that you're responsible for it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I like all of it. I mean, I love, and as a director, and I love, leading people and then seeing them do so well on the stage after I've, hopefully inspired them to do their best. That's also something that's satisfying, too. So it's hard to say. But if I had to pick one, it would definitely be, I've got the bug, it would be acting.
Do you see yourself doing this for long term, for the rest of your life?
Oh, sure. Yeah, in some capacity or another. Yeah, definitely.
That's great. Who are your early influences? Is there any actresses or movie characters or anybody who just stuck out to you that was like a classic favorite of yours?
Well, I like actors, but not that I'm trying to emulate.
I never say anything about emulate. Inspire to create your own.
I love Rucker Hauer's one of my favorites. I love him. Jonathan Pryce is another one that I will watch pretty much anything that he does. I'm not sure why I gravitated towards those two actors. I just think they're such wonderful actors that I will just watch anything that they will do.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much.
So when did you start getting into producing from acting? Was it just as early, or did something come up to where you were
weren't getting sure? Into producing was a complete accident.
That sounds like it's usually how it happens.
It was completely an accident. It did begin with Repo. I did Rocky Horror back in college. And I wasn't involved in running it. I just did the props and I was an extra. And I wasn't even in the main show at the time, even though I really wanted to be. But back then, and where I went in the group that I was involved with, somebody pretty much had to die before you got a part in the show. Because, like, you know, it was always the same people. And I promised myself that if I ever did that, I would. And we'll get to that, too. But I saw Repo and I thought, what, this should be a shadow cast, like Rocky Horror. I mean, it's a musical. It's got dark themes. It's catchy. This thing needs to be a shadow cast.
Right.
And then I found out, to my dismay, that it had already been thought of. But I said, you know what, to hell with it. They were doing it somewhere in Canada that I heard about. I'm like, to hell with it. Let's do it. So I got a group together. And, you know, it was meant to just be like my college group was. You got together once a month on a Saturday, you did a show, and you went home, and that was it. It didn't end up being that way at all. I ended up booking us a monthly gig, and then money started getting involved, and it just kind of went from there. And then a couple of years later, I found myself in the same off-Broadway house that the original play that the movie was based on had been performed in New York. And we did it there, too.
Wow.
So, like I said, I thought we were just going to be doing Repo for a little while. I didn't know where it was going to go. And then all of a sudden, we're doing Repo. Then we're adding Rocky. Then it becomes a production company. Then all the aspects of theater and technical theater are all starting to converge and come into it. And like, this is the real deal. And that's basically how it happened back in 2009, and just been blossoming ever since.
Do you find producing as just as hard to make money in as acting?
Or, oh, yeah. I mean, definitely. I mean, you have to know so much more to make money producing than you do acting, because you have to know the booking. You have to know what everything's going to cost. Mm-hmm. The technical end of it's going to cost. It's so you're budgeting.
So you're basically losing more than you're making.
No. Oh, okay. Thankfully,
but
no.
If you're making anything.
But it took a while to get to that point.
Okay.
No, we're not losing anymore. We were for a number of years, but not anymore. Mm. But it took years to really be able to perfect that and to say, you know, there's a time somebody gave me a great piece of advice once, you know, don't do anything for free, yeah. You know, when you're an artist. Yeah. And I took that to heart. And after that, I didn't do anything for free. And that's when we really started to take off.
It's like that Heath Ledger Joker line from The Dark Knight. If you're good at something, never do it for free.
Exactly. You know? Mm-hmm. And there's so many. And I have to say that I've seen so many people running events and things like that who take advantage of people. You know, they won't hire someone who they have to pay. And, you know, their events suffer for it. They do. You know, and when we hire people to do pre-shows for us, we pay them. Because I've been on the other side of that.
What's the craziest thing you've seen behind the scenes?
Ooh.
When it comes to shows or films or any project you've done in the past.
Oh, gosh.
Anything you can repeat.
Sure.
Well, we're TVMA, so it's only up to what she wants to talk about.
I'd have to pick. I mean, it's terrible. I mean, I've seen horrible fights with the production staff in front of the cast.
Like
screaming matches.
Oh, okay. Are they talking about screaming, UFC?
No, physical fights? No.
Okay.
But I've seen screaming matches between the production staff right in front of the cast. And I've seen that more than once. it's the most unprofessional thing you can do is start screaming at somebody. And someone tried to do that to me once. They started screaming at me in front of my cast. I said, I'm not going to do this. Because this is not...
You have zero tolerance.
Oh, no, yeah. No. So we're not going to argue in front of the cast like this. I mean, mm-hmm. It's just not going to happen. No, I don't put up with that.
Good.
But I'm trying to think if there's anything else crazy that I saw. crazier than that. I mean, that's definitely...
We got a call. Joe, you want to answer that?
Good.
Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, is this Mr. Sawyer?
Yes, who is this? Hello?
Oh, this is Bertha, Bertha Bukowski.
Oh, Bertha. Hey, honey. Let me go get dice for you. Hold on. Yeah, oh, who yes, is this? Please. Who is this, the broad I was with the other night?
Oh, honey, you remembered me.
Oh, you remembered me. I left you the receipt and everything.
Oh, my goodness. I can't believe you remembered me.
Oh, I love the gag sound. It's how
oh,
I
get... God. Don't you start again, mister.
That's how you get the kids a new TV set.
Oh.
You have a question for Requiem over here?
Yes. Is Mr. Sawyer single?
I wouldn't know.
I said a question, not anything like, about her. Are you on
sorry,
something?
I can't help myself. He's so big and strong.
Oh, dear.
Okay, anything else? Any questions or whatnot? Are you just going to rant like a little pervert?
One more question.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you like older women?
How older?
Oh, honey, just think of it as maybe, as, I don't remember, actually.
We're talking 40s or higher than that?
Oh, higher, honey, go up.
Pain up. All right. Thank you for that, Miss... What was her name?
Bertha.
Bertha. That sounds like... Whenever you go on a blind date with someone named Bertha, you shouldn't attend that blind date.
What if you don't know the name before you go on the date?
Well, that's different. Then you just take the surprise and go get...
Take one for the team?
Yeah.
Okay.
So speaking of crazy...
Yes.
We were talking about... Sorry for that interruption.
That's okay.
We get some creeps who like to follow.
I understand. Show.
Speaking of crazy, let's fast forward to the time you were at Chamber of Horrors.
Oh,
New York.
Oh dear, yeah.
My first gig in the acting industry. Oh. Actually, you know, we weren't there at the same time.
Yeah, but, I did Chamber for a few years. I did it 2011 and 2013, and that's actually when I started getting back in more into the horror acting, and created my horror persona, so it's actually I have a vampire character that I portray as well.
Okay,
so
yeah, the one I got from working there was just it's like a cross between The Walking Dead and Cabin in the Woods.
No, I created my own character. When I had started there, there was some other creative staff in charge, and we were allowed to create our own. And I've kind of run with that since then, and I still occasionally pull that out. I want to do more with it. I used to be part of a team, but now I'm kind of flying solo with it. So I'm trying to figure out what direction that I'm going in with it. So right. I'm not sure yet.
Have you ever considered bringing back that character to life for any future productions or anything?
I'd like to. Like I said, I'm just trying to figure out what direction I'm going in with her.
So during your time there, and I'll bring up some old stories from when I was there in a second, but which was more fun for you while working there? Being in the actual set itself or going outside and screwing with the people online while they're waiting to come in?
I started as Q-Line, and okay. that was my lifeblood. I loved messing with the people outside. It was the greatest thing. We would creep up to the ticket booth. They weren't paying attention. They were buying their tickets. They turn around. So that was definitely my favorite. Yeah, I did like that. I liked the roaming.
Mm-hmm.
I probably that first year I walked like 3 miles a night roaming the whole place.
Oh my god! Same here. Whenever they would tell me to go on break, they would always give me the option to go out there. So I remember teaming up with one of the actresses on set who had like this bloody nurse thing going on,
mm-hmm.
and I had the whole redneck zombie thing, and we would take this long hardware chain, and she would wrap around my neck like a leash and make it seem like I'm one of her patients being let out for social hour. So I'm lunging at kids and barking at grown men and sniffing, you know, people online, and all the women are like, oh, my God, let me get a picture of
him. Oh, they love – I have great pictures with the with the patrons. They all wanted to take pictures
The patrons?
Yeah.
That's what you guys call them.
Back then, yeah.
That's a professional term.
I call them victims.
Also a good one.
So, favorite movie of all time?
Favorite movie of all time. Probably Blade Runner.
Blade Runner?
Probably, yeah.
Does that have any influence or ties into any of your past work or current work you have coming up?
No. No? I just love Blade. I mean, like, that's where I found Rucker Hauer, you know, his work at first. So, you know, I love that concept, that world, you know, of, you know, the vision of the future. It was just such a beautiful movie, too.
Right.
And I found the character of Roy Batty very interesting.
Right.
You know, pondering his life being so short, you know, trying, you know, questioning going to his creator, questioning his creator, begging his creator for more life. And, you know, it's just, and I remember one of the lines is, I'm going to screw this up too, because I don't remember it exactly, but it's the light that burns twice as brightly burns half as long. I believe that's the line. I love that line. I just absolutely love that line.
Joe, you got anything?
No, I'm good.
Really? You're just going to leave me out there like that?
Right now. Give me like another 5 minutes.
Okay.
You're doing fine.
So,
if things go bad, I'll take over. It's cool.
So when it comes to actors and performers in the performing arts, I really find guys like Heath Ledger and most of the character actors, you know, quite interesting, because, you know, they have that method of staying in the role, you know, throughout the entire time, you know, shooting, to really just become one with the character as if it's, you know, a real human being or an actual, you know, personality. Are you the same way?
Do
you
Absolutely. I mean, I always try, whatever character I'm playing, I really have to get inside their head, you know, and it's until I get to that point, it's kind of two-dimensional. But, oh, I'm definitely that way. You know, I'll research the period, you know, that the piece takes place in to see what kind of mindset that they might have had during that era. You know, I did a piece that was set in the 1930s last year, and I had to, you know, some of the lines to me, of course, you know, reading them in 2016 were, you know, I was a little taken aback by how she was, but then I had to remember women were taught different things back then. They observed different things in society, so they may have thought something differently. You know, so I didn't think she was such a strong woman, you know, when I first read the play. But, like, yeah, she is a strong woman. You know, according to her time, she was.
Do you ever find that when you're doing something like that, that kind of when you're trying to take over the persona of this character you're doing, that it ever carries over into your real life?
Oh, yeah. Sometimes, yeah, that does happen. Some of the characters were only some of them. Some of the characters I've played, I wouldn't want to carry into my, you know, some of the more horror characters that I wouldn't want that to go. But yeah, I mean, you can start, you know, seeing things from a different perspective because you're playing a certain character. Absolutely.
Describe your process on creating the character, like how it starts to the final product itself. Like, what do you think of first? Do you think of the background? Do you think of how they look? You know.
Well, yeah, you got to start from the beginning. I mean, are you talking about creating a character as in taking something that's written on paper or actually creating one from scratch? Because it's two different
processes. Well, in your case, creating one from scratch, okay. But either or.
Sure. You always got to start, you know, some people like to, you know, they like to name their character first. That's the last thing you do. Mm-hmm. That's always the last thing you do. You have to first find out you have to know where they were born, when they were born, who their parents were. Did they grow up wealthy? Did they grow up poor? Did they speak? Were they an immigrant, or were they born in where they're residing? How intelligent are they? And then once you figured all of that out, I love names. I'm a big name nerd. And I love to pick names that the average person may not understand relates to the character, but I know it does, so it tickles me. For example, my vampire character, her name is Zoe Durand, and that means life everlasting in French.
Oh, wow.
Or life unending, enduring. So, but you know, people who don't speak French, you know, the average Joe wouldn't know that. But I know it, and it tickles me. Because it's not terribly obvious,
right?
But there it is. But that's always the name is always last.
Does it take a while for you to come up with these pieces of information, or is it sometimes quicker than other?
It depends. I mean, it really depends on the type of character and if I'm creating it from scratch. It's usually a little longer than if, you know, it's something written on paper, and then I'll have to go back, do the research, and...
Can you do it by simply looking at somebody?
Can you
create a character by simply looking at somebody and just thinking, you know, okay, he looks like so-and-so, so this could be whatever, and...
No, but something I have done is and even in the haunt setting, I did help some people create haunt characters. Like, I said, okay, what do you want to do? Mm-hmm. Like, what do you want to be, a zombie or this and that? And okay. And then I'll ask them the questions like I was just saying, where do you want them to come from? Mm-hmm. How did they grow up? And by asking them these questions, they're able to, in fact, create the character themselves.
Right.
So...
If you are just joining us, we are in studio with Requiem Aeternam from the Scream Sisters podcast and of Zen Productions. Our phone lines are still open at 516-945-9099. Again, the number is 516-945-9099. I asked just now if you could create the character by looking at somebody, because I wanted to try something real quick. If you could take a good look at him, mm-hmm. and come up with anything for him, like off the spot, like are you... quick like that, or do you need time?
No, he's not looking at me. Oh, he's got very intense eyes.
I hear that a lot, actually. Yeah. We call it very expressive.
But yeah, you're like it's like burning, you know. So for me, that would be somebody who had some kind of a mental, like if we're going horror character, not mental illness.
Thanks, Bobby.
Mental illness.
Thanks.
Mental power, not mental illness. like a mental type power.
Okay.
Because the eyes, you know, you could just look at someone and it would almost be like they would feel like, you know, they were either being manipulated or mesmerized or something like that. So some type of character like that, I would suggest.
Like some whack job or something?
No, not even a whack job.
I definitely see him as a whack job.
Thanks.
If it were, it would be very subtle. Like, you wouldn't know he was a whack job right away.
Like, silent at first, but yeah, then goes like, nuts in like a like, second.
You know, he's like, you know, and as he goes on, you say, okay, something's not right with him.
Right.
That kind of.
Not totally inaccurate.
That's true.
I'll admit that.
So have you ever thought of putting a Dicis in one of your shows? I'm only kidding.
A what?
Dicis. Dice, Andrew Dice Clay and Isis.
Oh,
what I did in the opening of the show. The mouse with the missing...
Dices.
It's going to be a comedy fight, blah. So...
Oh, the comedy fatwa got
fatwa.
Me.
We beheading people, so you beheading over the Allah Akbar and grill in Tunisia.
I'd like to see what Dices looked like.
Oh, probably no different than the other scumbags over there.
Oh,
yes, I called them scumbags, USA. That was so corny, I know. So yeah. We know that you are a huge wrestling fan.
And I am, yeah.
Yeah, and you happen to be... good friends with them.
I knew you were going to go there. Not that good.
Oh, I've seen the pictures. You two look good.
Oh,
tight.
Come on.
With one Gangrel.
Yeah, I've met him a few times.
From the Brood.
Yeah, I've met him a few times. And I talked to him on Facebook a little bit. I wouldn't say we're like great friends, best friends or anything. No. I don't want him to think I'm crazy.
See, she's getting all red when I'm talking about you. Yeah,
I don't want him to think I'm like a crazy stalker or something. Jeez.
He probably digs that.
He probably thinks I am or anybody. Anyway.
I mean, he hung out with Luna all that time.
That's right. Yeah. R.I.P. She was awesome, though.
Did you ever hear that story about her scaring off the Insane Clown Posse from a Raw taping?
No. That I did not hear. I have not heard that one.
I think it was Russo.
Luna Vachon.
Luna Vachon, yeah. I think Vince Russo or somebody who is in charge of booking matches put them two against Luna and told Luna to like beat the shit out of them the entire time because they were like being disrespectful backstage. Mm-hmm. So the second they got word, they just took the nearest cab and never returned back.
Oh, man. She was intense.
Yeah. And she had that voice that could just make you cringe. And, that was a real voice too.
It was her real voice.
Tons of tobacco smoke and lots of drugs that made me start talking like this.
I think she just inherited it from her father. Honestly,
Daddy, what? Oh, I'm gonna go wrestle now. Okay, honey, I love you.
Yeah, I mean, you see her in interviews. She talks like that.
Yeah.
She does.
It's like the Randy Savage. People think that voice he did was all a shtick. He really did sound like that whenever he would talk in his personal life. To the point where he'd be on the road with the Ultimate Warrior, and Warrior would tell him at like restaurants, Randy, don't talk. Let me order your food. let me order your food for you. Don't say a word. Because the second he went out,
we need time out for a second. That could have been a great reality show in itself. Ultimate Warrior and Randy Savage traveling together.
Oh, my God. I want to be a fly on the wall for that
one. Can you imagine being at, like, a Coney Diner in East Side Slippin' here, and, I'll take your scramble with a side of fries and a root beer float with extra caffeine in it. Uh-huh. Go easy on the sodium. So you a lifelong wrestling fan?
I came back to it a few years ago. I was when I was younger, and then like I said, when the Bushwhackers went into the Hall of Fame a couple years back, I said, oh yeah, the Bushwhackers. Oh my God, I remember them. I used to watch them every weekend, and then I got lost in a YouTube hole. And after that, the rest is history. And
One of the main themes of our program is professional wrestling, and we find it quite interesting how other performers from different avenues in entertainment, they were once a fan or they were influenced by it. I like to think that wrestling has such a powerful hold on pop culture, throughout the world when it comes to music, sports, politics, and all that. I mean, but Conor McGregor was walking like Vince McMahon at a UFC fight at one point, So we think it's interesting that, someone like you who's obviously been around acting and producing for a while, I'm assuming, was once a fan and still is a fan of that. It just shows that the business is not dying anytime soon.
I mean, we got a guy that in my cast right now. He's a local professional wrestler.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he is. Well, you may know him as Razzle Dazzle.
Oh my God. Yeah, I know who you're talking about.
Yeah.
This guy has on like a high school bully nerd, kind of outfit going on with the yellow collar shirt and the khaki shorts, one of those things. He comes out with a sock puppet, right?
Has he showed you
his gimmick or no?
I've seen pictures.
Oh, okay.
I've actually not been able, because he usually is wrestling when we're rehearsing, so.
This radio station in Deer Park, and I'm not going to say their names because they're a bunch of assholes, but they had like a worst gimmick ever contest, and it was like a yearly thing. It was him. It would always came down to me versus him for the finals. And it was always a 50-50,
between them. He won't let it go.
I'm not kidding.
Let me tell you, we've all tried to talk him out of, so come on, let us work on a new game. Come on, between all of us, we can think of something. No. All right.
So. Yeah, he probably didn't want any flack from his higher power, his bosses, over there.
So,
considering that I've seen met some of them in person.
Yeah.
Quick little story. I remember being at an indie show, I was working for one company at the time, and I was looking to get work at this particular company. And I remember meeting the promoter, and he found out that I was with the company I was with, and he goes, "Oh, I'm so sorry." I'm like, "What?" He goes, "Yeah, I'm really sorry for you, man." I see him 2 months later. I'm like, "Hey, I'm John. We met a couple months ago." He goes, "Oh yeah, you're the kid who I said I'm so sorry to." I'm like, "Yeah, how come you said that?" He goes, "Well, if I was homeless, I wouldn't want to tell people I was homeless."
Oh man.
I'm like, "Geez, the hostility." Like, whatever happened to just, you know, putting on product for the public to enjoy, and not this whole, you know, we got to outdo these guys or outdo these guys, you know. Yeah,
unfortunately, there's a lot of that going on everywhere in any type of entertainment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like to me, the competition should be within that one place, mm-hmm. you know, to see who can work harder, you know, to do better, because that's only just going to create a better outcome for the viewing audience. Whether it's plays, movies, haunted mm-hmm. houses, pro wrestling, you know, music, mm-hmm. music events, yep. you know, if the opening act does great, that should inspire the headlining exactly. act to just completely destroy it. Mm-hmm. You know, if an opening comic, you know, does fantastic and kills with jokes, that should make the headliner more motivated to go out there and just slay the entire audience, because he's the headliner for a reason. Mm-hmm. Not that
meanwhile, it's looked at totally the opposite way.
I know, and it's so sad.
Yeah. The only time that gets a little old is when you got imitators.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And people who want to, and people who pretend that they're legitimate in mm-hmm. that field when they really aren't. Like, I've seen a ton of them in wrestling, and I'm sure there's plenty of people watching this right now who think I'm one of those imitators. So, right there.
Ooh.
But there's plenty of that in comedy, plenty of that in music, and plenty of that with you guys.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. People who think that just because they, worked on a family farm in a low-key Amen. Haunted house, that they're Jack Nicholson all of a sudden.
Exactly, you know. Mm-hmm. I've been doing this, you know, I've been producing for 8 years now. So, you know, all power to you if you want to go out there, do something original, learn how to produce and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But when you're trying to do the same thing and you're going against somebody who's been doing this stuff for 8 years... You know, it's a different game. It's a different game.
Is there anybody in the performing arts who you want to work with in the future? Anybody who you would love to just team up with for a live event or a movie or anyone like that?
That's really interesting. Well, I mean, we've been really lucky because we've been doing Repo Salon for 8 years mm-hmm. that we've been able to work with the creator, both of the creators of Repo. We've had come out to our shows. We've hosted them, done special events with them. The creator of Repo appeared last year at the Steampunk World's Fair in New Jersey, and we went out there. We did Repo out there with him, and he's known us since the beginning. Mm. So those kind of collaborations are great. I mean, last 2 years, we did shows at Patchogue Theater, which was amazing.
I saw pictures.
We sold out both of those shows.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the roar of 1,000 people that are there to see you and your company, there's just nothing like that in the world.
Yeah.
You know?
That's a good feeling, knowing that these people are, you know, here, and you're one of the reasons, you know? We got to wrap up soon. I think mm-hmm. it's...
we got 10 minutes.
10 minutes or so? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You got anything before we close out?
Now, you're with Scream Sisters podcast?
Yes, I've been meaning to bring that
Sisters,
up. Scream Sisters, yes.
You know, I told you, when things go off the rails, I'll just take over. It's fine. Yeah. what got you into that kind of thing, into horror movies, and specifically doing a podcast about them?
Well, horror movies I've been into since my father decided it was a good idea to show me Poltergeist at age 7.
It's funny. I was just talking to somebody about this. I was brought to see Gremlins at a drive-in mm. when it came out, and I was like 4 or 5 years old. Nightmares. Mm.
All night. I didn't have night. You know, I always loved horror. I mean, from a young age, you know, and I get, you know, my dad was a big influence on me as far as, you know, the unusual kind of stuff, like Rocky Horror and science fiction and horror movies and things like that.
I'm more into the type of movies where there's that psychological horror where like it's based off of real life situations.
I'm not a slasher film person.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of the Purge series.
I'm sorry?
The Purge.
Okay.
You know, like Election Year and Anarchy, with Frank Grillo and all those guys. You know, I think it's a fantastic series, a great story plot, and, you know, and it's very well done. The only thing I don't like about the film is that there are, you know, we talked about, you know, creeps and, you know, whack jobs who lurk around entertainment all the time. There's plenty of them who just beg and wish for that to be a real thing. To the point where during this past election, they were like, oh, if Donald Trump wins, he's probably going to make it legal because him and his sons look like the people from the movie. And I remember sitting there like, why? Why? But films like that and any Jason Voorhees film, like Jason X was the earliest memory I have when they're all on that spaceship. And, yeah.
It was so funny.
Yeah.
But as far as Scream Sisters getting started, a friend of mine she's a writer. Misty Pendragon, she publishes under. She got the
idea.
I've
heard the name before.
Yeah. Oh, you have? Oh, yes. Great. She'll be glad to hear that. She got the idea to do a podcast about women in horror because there's a lot of, you know, there aren't a lot of female directors and as many female directors and writers and producers of horror. And we have gotten such a great reception from so many people. I mean, we had, who do we have on? We had, no, it wasn't Seth Green. Adam Green. They got Adam Green. I wasn't there for that. Bill Moseley from Repo has been on. We had him. The guy who played Pinhead in the Hellraiser.
Oh, my God. Really?
We got him.
Which is some of my favorite.
He was great.
Was he in person or did he call him?
No, that was out of the film. There's also a guy locally, James Balsamo.
I've heard of him. Yes,
he does. He does really campy movies, and we interviewed him. He's a local guy. I think he moved out to L.A. now. He was hysterical. He was great. But we've gotten some good interviews so far, and you know, just having and it's all female. All the, you know, the cohort panelists are female, and it's a little bit of rotation, but it's mostly Misty and myself and Jess and
Misty
Jeanette.
Who?
Misty Pendragon.
Okay.
And, you know, we just talk about our perspectives in horror. And the next one that we're going to be doing is on Final Girls. Final Girls being the last one left alive at the end of a horror movie, you know, and the evolution of the final girl. Why is it always a girl, you know?
Have you done anything on the black guy being the first one dead?
No. Oh, my gosh. No.
I mean, it's true that these are like 80s like horror movie tropes right there. It's like,
yeah.
Like the black guy is the first one dead.
The final girl is...
If you have sex, you're dead.
Yeah.
Yeah. The final girl is a big, big trope.
Yes.
It's always... But what, you know, we're going to discuss, why is it always a girl at the end? Why isn't it a guy? You know? So so that's the subject of our next one. But yeah, we've had great, you know... I haven't been, but because most of them are located in New England. I'm the only one here in New York, but they've been to a few cons up. They did Rock and Shock and a bunch of those up there, but yeah, we're starting to get a little more audience than we had at the beginning. But you know, it's definitely a niche that wasn't being filled. You know, women in horror. And there's a I just heard of a project. I can't recall the name of it, but it's an anthology movie, and they're all female directors.
Yes, I've heard. I know the one you're talking about. I can't think of the name of it either.
I recently saw it, like within the last few days. But it's all female directors. So that's something, and I'd love to see if we can get those directors on the show. That would be just fantastic.
Where can people find the podcast?
That would it's on iTunes, and you could visit our Facebook at Scream Sisters. So and you know, we're on Twitter also, but yeah, iTunes has it. So look us up.
Okay.
It's really a fun time.
Right. How long have you been doing that?
I think a year and a half now. I mean, it's very sporadic. We're trying to make it a little more regular, But, you know, every month, 2 months, we get one out, you know.
Well, we got to wrap this up within the next 5 or 4 minutes. So we'd like to thank you for coming down and accepting the invitation to be on. Of course, the door is always open if you wish to come by in the future. If you'd like to plug your social media real quick.
Please. My personal social media, I'm on Facebook. I'm at Requiem2056, also Twitter, also Instagram, all Requiem2056.
Now, what is that? What's the 2056?
That's a Repro reference. That's the year that Repro takes place in.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So that's what the 2056 is. A little nod to that. As far as Zen Productions, that's Zen Productions New York. It's on Facebook, Twitter. I keep everything very uniform as far as that goes. And we'll be at Heliosphere in Tarrytown, New York on March 10th doing Repo. We'll be at Dark Side of the Con in Piscataway, New Jersey on March 18th doing Repo. And then we'll be at Lunacon, and that is in April 7th through 9th. And that will be Rocky Horror and Little Shop. I'm not sure which nights they're on yet, but we'll be doing all those Shadowcasts.
And this is Zen Productions New York on Facebook for more info?
Zen Productions New York on Facebook for more info. And that'll link to, we do have names for the different casts. You know,
The
Rocky cast has a name and the Repo cast has a name, but it all goes through Zen Productions New York. That's the parent company.
All right.
So.
Well, thank you for coming down.
Thanks for having me. Right. It was great.
Her tour, the Zen Productions tour kicks off on March 10th. Like she said, visit Zen Productions New York on Facebook for more information. Other than that, you got anything? Want to wrap it up?
No, we're good tonight. We did a good job. You did. I did great, as usual.
That's the usual. I do, and you just completely steal it from me.
Yeah. I'm the heel.
He is Evil Joe. He is, as I told him last week, the Jerry Lawler to my Jim Ross over here.
Yes. I mean, a little high praise for yourself there. I'm fine with being the Jerry Lawler.
I'm fine with being the Jim Ross.
You're more like the Tony Schiavone.
Oh, shut the fuck. He is at EvilJoe3 on Facebook and Twitter. I am at JohnSawyer76 on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you guys for watching. We will see you next week.